Thank you for coming on time today. Like yesterday, inikum time ku aarambika pora session. When we started planning this edition's Tamil Nadu Economic Policy Dialogue, oru topic a mukhyama we thought we should discuss in this dialogue at length is the water issue. So we have themed this session as to how to transform Tamil Nadu into a water positive state. And when we thought of this session, we had three options for speakers. Option one, Dr.Anbumani Ramadoss. Option two, Dr.Anbumani Ramadoss. Option three, Dr.Anbumani Ramadoss. Because he is passionate about not just the state, as well as important issues like this. And as soon as we sent him the invite, he readily agreed to be with us. An out-of-the-box, innovative leader for our state. We are glad, sir, you are in the parliament representing our voice. And gratitude specially for accepting this invitation. I invite you to come on to the dais, sir. I also call upon Tirisham Shekhar, founder of iThought, to introduce sir formally and begin this session.
Friends, it's a great privilege and honor to introduce to you probably one of the foremost change agents that we have seen in the public life in Tamil Nadu in the last 20 years. I'm just going to place before you some of the things which he has been a part of, catalyzed, started, and grown. How many of you are aware that it was during his tenure that several important institutions of our polity began their journey? The Public Health Foundation of India is one. The National Institute of Communicable Diseases, another. When you buy every food product, you see that it is FSSAI certified today. When you order food on Swiggy, every kitchen is FSSAI certified. The FSSAI was established under his ministership. The National Rural Health Mission was also a baby that birthed under his ministership. There are several programs that he launched towards eradication of malaria, immunization, polio eradication, and integrated everything into path-breaking national health schemes. In a sense, many of the good things that are happening today started when he was the health minister. But above all these things, most of you who go to movie theaters, go to public spaces, travel in buses, trains, flights, go to several places, may not even be aware that prior to his being the National Health Minister, Union Health Minister, all these spaces were infested with the evil of smoking, and he probably deserves the highest praise and credit for eradicating smoking in public spaces. So in that sense, a lot of the clean air that you are experiencing today has its genesis in his pioneering efforts to free our public spaces of smoking. It is all the more appropriate and befitting that today he's speaking to us on another element of nature, water, which is even more important to us in the current context. And it also speaks volumes that a politician active in public life with so much of engagements and commitments to their party, workers and duties, takes the time out, comes, bees in the midst of all of us and shares their thoughts in the public domain with an openness and a willingness. To that, our gratitude is eternal, sir, and we look forward to hearing from you.
Mr. Sudarshan, convener, Tamil Nadu Young Thinkers Forum. Mr. Shyam Shekhar, the moderator and an economist himself. Friends, I wish you all a very good morning, and I'm very happy to be here addressing issues on water. In the second Tamil Nadu Economic Policy Dialogue Conclave, I have addressed water issues in this very same platform, I think, last year. How can we make Tamil Nadu a water positive state? Before that, I just want to ask you a couple of questions. How many of you have heard about climate change? You can just raise your hands. Global warming and climate emergency. Okay, thank you. I've been going to different colleges in the last couple of months talking about climate change and global warming and climate emergency and climate action. And when I ask them about how many of them have heard about it, out of about 2,000, I see just a couple of hands up. It's very demoralizing for me that the younger generation of today have not heard about, even heard about, a concept called climate change. And in reality, I think this is the problem we are facing today. It's a huge, huge problem. And the only generation which could save, I'm coming to a point of saving Earth, saving mankind, humanity. About 20, 30 years ago, when people said that the world is going to end sometime soon or something, we used to laugh. Not during our time, not in the next 100, 200, 300, 500 years. The Earth is about 4.5 billion years old, and it's got another 5 billion years to go. But then today, the scientists are saying, the United Nations scientists, the United Nations special body called the IPCC, Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. It's a conglomerate of about 48 scientific bodies of different countries, and then they say that, yes, it's a reality. 150 years ago, the Earth's average temperature was about 14 degrees centigrade. That is before the Industrial Revolution. Today, it is 15 degrees, to 0.15.1 degrees centigrade. And just 1 degree centigrade in the last 150 years, see, so many problems we are facing about cyclones, super typhoons. Typhoons occur in the Pacific Ocean. I mean, they call typhoons all the same. Number cyclone is called typhoons in Pacific, hurricanes in Atlantic, and then Namaka cyclones. So it's the same. But you have super storms, super typhoons, super cyclones, a deluge of rain, Mumbai. This 3 weeks back, 242 millimeters in one day, 24 hours. The Tamil Nadu's average rainfall is 950 millimeters a year. Mumbai had 242 millimeters in one day. Just one day rainfall. This is something which we are looking at, and the climate change is something where we have to indulge in and then take mitigation and adaptive procedures. And when you say me, the government has to take a lot of policies. But Sudarshan, enakku vandu thaniya or topic, climate change, and I want to address a lot of people. Water is related, but then I'm going to focus on water here and Tamil Nadu being a positive state, because both are literally linked. At the same time, I'd like to say, coming back to the point of Tamil Nadu, people, neenga nenachirpeenga, Tamil Nadu, climate change issues, water, a shortage of rainfall, appa kaalathila a lot of rain was there, today it has decreased. No, that's not the point. 30 years ago, Tamil Nadu had an average rainfall of 850 millimeters. Today it is increased by 100 millimeters, 950 millimeters. It has got enough of rain. Israel has got only 50 millimeters. We have got 950 millimeters. Andhra has got 850 millimeters average. My statistics will be little plus or minus, like, it's not exact. When I say 950, it's go 952, like, concept. Karnataka has got about, on the Coorg area, where a Kaveri main is there, like, basin is there. There, it's about 3,000 millimeters. But then you go further north in Karnataka, it's about only 750 millimeters. Kerala has got about 3,500. That's a different concept. Like. So out of these states, Tamil Nadu has got more rainfall. But the problem in Tamil Nadu is saving the rainfall, storing them. That is the biggest problem, biggest challenge we're facing. I just put into the quantity, a TMC, I'm sure a lot of you know what is a TMC, 1,000 million cubic feet. One TMC is 1,000 million cubic feet. One cubic feet is about 1 by 1 by 1. It contains about 28 liters of water, one cubic feet, foot. So when you say 1,000 million, it's about a billion in sense, 100 crores. So 100 crores into 28, it's about 2,800 crore liter of water is one TMC. And Tamil Nadu's total capacity of storage in all our reservoirs, our tanks, our dams and lakes and rivers, it's approximately about 170 TMC of water. Metu Dam, it's the biggest dam. It can store about 93 TMC of water. The second biggest dam is Bhavani Sagar Dam. It can store about 31 TMC of water. The rest are all kuti-kuti, small. Chambarambakkam can store about 3.5 TMC when it's full. So 170 TMC of water is our storage, approximately. The storage in Karnataka is about approximately 350 TMC of water. Sorin said they have built capacities. Storage in Andhra, where they have 850 millimeters of rainfall, is about approximately 550 TMC. Namak, it's only 170, Andhra, 550 TMC of water. So this is the problem. This is the biggest problem we are facing. We haven't increased our capacity to store water in the last 50, 60 years. Even though we have a lot of rainfall, copious amount of rainfall. But another issue facing Tamil Nadu, not only Tamil Nadu, but our neighboring states, is the monsoon. We have two monsoons. Tamil Nadu has got northeast monsoon and southwest monsoon. The northeast monsoon is a predominant monsoon for us. About 45% of Tamil Nadu gets northeast monsoon. And then 37% is about southwest monsoon. The rest is in between, we have rains. Like. Even though entire India, you take India in the context, is about 80%, nearly 80% of India is dependent on southwest monsoon. Like. But the problem is, earlier we had this monsoon for about 42 to 44 days. Today we are having it only for 34 days. Like. But the rainfall is increased, the period is shortened. So, an avalanche in Ooty, in 4 days we had 200 millimeters of rain. Just in 4 days. We don't want that to happen. We want it to rain, but it should be staggered. Then when it goes down to the soil. There are two things which happens. Like one, water runs off into the sea quickly. Second is it washes off the topsoil even quicker. So there's no soil to absorb the water and put it, percolate it down. Chennai, we are dependent on groundwater. I don't know how many of you know it. We could say fancy things like Viranam water and then the Krishna water and then suddenly we have water from Tirupatur coming and all by tankers and all these. These are all minuscule amount of water. Chennai is dependent on groundwater. And then my experts say that in another 2 years, there's not going to be enough of groundwater at all. It's becoming a red district, red place. So these are the things like it needs to be addressed. We have rain. We have beautiful rivers in Tamil Nadu. We have about 33 big major rivers. And out of that, we have 5 major rivers. I could say the Palar, the north, then a little south, we have the Tenpennai River. Then the biggest of them, Kaveri River. Then a little further is Vaigai. And then a little further down is Tamrabarani. But then we have other rivers as well. I said 33 major rivers. Then 5 big rivers out of that. Tamrabarani is the only perennial river we have. And the others are all dependent on the monsoon. And most of the rivers, I mean, I could say almost all of them, except I think Vaigai, are dependent from other states for us. Like. They fall, the catchment is in other states. Like. So that is a problem we're facing where we have not had capacities to store these waters when they flow during the rivers. Experts say because of climate change, we're going to face huge droughts. There'll be a huge deluge of flood. You see rain in Chennai, 2015. I'm sure all of you have experienced that huge flood we had. They said once in 100-year rain we had. So this is going to be more frequent now. Earlier we said once in 100-year flood. Once in 100-year rain. Now these words are going to be more frequent heard. That's what the experts are saying. But 2015, we had a flood in Chennai. 2016 summer, we didn't have water to drink. What an irony it is. Flood 6 months before, drought 6 months later. It's a shame on us, actually. Because we haven't had ideas to store this flood. So we shouldn't think of floods as a curse. We should think floods as a boon hereafter. When floods come, we shouldn't think of that. We should welcome it, like, however it is like. It may damage us a little bit here and there, but then this is something given, water given by nature. We have to store every drop of it. Like, so this is something where we have gone astray because we haven't been able to harness such huge amounts of water. Take Kaveri. Kaveri River supplies about 20 districts of Tamil Nadu. Today, I think we have 35 districts. It was 32, now three more new created. 35 districts. So out of that, 20 districts, including Chennai, gets water from Kaveri. Kaveri, Tala Kaveri, Coorg area, and it's about 800 kilometers. And out of that, 317 kilometers in Karnataka, and then border about 70 kilometers the border, and then 400 in Tamil Nadu. Karnataka, initially they had only one dam. That was the KRS, Krishna Raj Sagar Dam, built by the Mysore Raja at the time. And that capacity is about 45 TMC. We also at the time built Mettur Dam. When say we, the Britishers built it, I think 1934. And that capacity is 93 TMC. Then Karnataka later on built a little more, many more dams like that Kabini, Hemavati, Harangi, Swarnavati, like this, on the branches of the Kaveri. Like. So now their capacity is about 104 TMC. Our capacity is still 93 TMC. But the problem is, in the last 15 years in the Kaveri, we let out 800 TMC of water into the sea. 800 TMC of water into the sea. And we fight with Karnataka, we fight with Kerala, we fight with Andhra for water. When we get water, we don't have capacity to store it. Example, this year, just take this year. Mettur Dam was filled in, I think, September 9th this year. And since September 9th, just less than a month, 13 TMC of water approximately have gone to the sea. How many of you, I mean, can you say that, what is the Chennai's requirement of water for 1 month or for 1 year? It's approximately 15 TMC. And each month we need about 1.5, approximately 1.5 TMC. 13 TMC already in the last 20-25 days have gone to the sea from the Kaveri. So again, this is the problem we face. Kaveri doesn't have a storage. It has only about one Mettur Dam. And then a little further in Trichy, near Trichy, it has got Melane, Kallane, Kirane. And these are all diversionary dams. It doesn't store water. It diverts water when there's flood. It diverts into a colliedom. And then, so we don't have capacity then. And these capacities could have been easily created. It's not something where you can't build, I'm not taking a dam, a check dam. A check dam may not be about 40, 50 feet. It can be about 5 feet or 10 feet. It can hold about half TMC. You build about 20 of them. You can get about 10 TMC. So each and every drop should be saved and should be stored. And that is something where we need to be indulgent in, and that's the policy where when you say we want to make Tamil Nadu into a positive, what a positive state. These, like some of these schemes, like every river has got a scheme. And these schemes have been pending. We have about 20 pending schemes in Tamil Nadu for the last 50, 60 years. Irrigation schemes, these are irrigation schemes. When you say 50, 60 years, it's something, it's a big problem we're having. For example, Attikaduva Avinasi scheme. Kaveri has three rivulets, like, or three branches. One is the Bhavani, another is the Noyal, and then the third is the Amaravati. And Bhavani River, Bhavani Sagar, from there the Bhavani River comes in and joins the Kaveri as well. So every year, or maybe once in 2 years, there's spate in the Bhavani, and about 7 to 20 TMC water is let out, excess water let out into the Kaveri, which goes to the sea. All this happens during the rainy season, the monsoon. So during the monsoon, the Delta region doesn't need water because it's already raining there as well. So then there's no water to, there's no kind of storage capacity for us as well. Like, and this water out of 7 to 20 TMC, they need 2 TMC water to take it into the interiors, which is a dry area. 1,800 feet, the bore well has gone there in the area. The Avinashi, the Perundurai, Annur, all these areas. Like. So that 2 TMC water, this scheme, Attikado Avinash scheme, was announced in 1962 by Mr. Kamaraj, the then chief minister. Then later he relinquished in 1962, and then Bhaktavachalam, then the other DMK all came. None of them did anything. At that time when it was conceptualized, the total cost of the project was 15 crores. Today it is 3,300 crores. So that is a colossal, I don't know how I put it, like it's a waste or, so this is something where now we have to introspect and think, where did we go wrong? And I'm telling just one scheme. There are other schemes in all the other rivers, like we say Tamrabarani. Tamrabarani is a perennial river, out of which nearly about 7 to 10 TMC water goes to the sea every year from Tamrabarani. Tamrabarani, the catchment area is in Podigai Malay, is in Kerala. And the beauty of that is it is a grass hill, like grassland. It rains, it absorbs the water, and then the grass, the mud and the grass releases bit by bit, drop by drop. It has a lot of copper. It's called Tamiram. Tamiram means copper in Tamil. And that releases, and then the water goes like. And Tamrabarani, two dams built by Mr. Kamaraj at the time. And then it has got about 6 check dams, Tamrabarani, out of which 5 were built by the kings, Esther kings, like. And 1 was built by the Britishers. None of them were built later on in the last 50, 60 years, like. And they have a scheme, Tamrabarani, Nambiyar, Karumeniyar, Pachayar, Korayar, Elumichar, like that. They have 6 branches, and then you link them. Now we have an election coming in Nanganeri. Nanganeri is a dry area. Tasian Valley, Nanganeri, Valliur, all that area. And this scheme, if it, they can make Nanganeri a fertile area. Tamrabarani, I think it cultivates about 1,10,000 acres. If this scheme is put up, it could cultivate 50,000 acres more. 50,000 acres more. So it could go to about 1,60,000 acres. Just like small linking, that's it. So these are the, so that end, and also it could take care of the drinking water for the entire 3 districts. Now I can say 4 districts, like Kanyakumari, Tirunelveli, Thoothukudi, and Virudhunagar. 4 districts, entire drinking water could take. If you store them copiously, like, so judiciously. Like. So that is one thing. Then we have the Vaigai River. Vaigai River, the problem with Vaigai, I say, when I say Vaigai, we see in a lot of Sangam Tamil, recently in Kiradi, when they found out artifacts about the Tamil culture, one of the oldest in the world and fought equal, or if not older than the Indus culture, and they had the carbon dating, to go to Miami, they say that's about 2,600 years old, these artifacts. So that is in the bank of the Vaigai River. These findings were on Kiradi. The Vaigai River, it starts from the Meghamalai or the Velli Malai, western, all these in the Western Ghats. And the problem there was, before this, they destroyed 1,60,000 acres of forest in these hills and converted them into tea estates. And there are, I think, about 26 villages there. So till this time, Vaigai had a copious amount of water flowing through it, and Ramanathapuram, I don't know, most of you have gone there, if they want to punish any government official, they send them to Ramanathapuram. Tannila Kaad. Ramanathapuram, Tannila Kaad. But Ramanathapuram was once one of the most fertile districts of Tamil Nadu, one point of time. When we had a lot of water for it, when there's no tea estates in the hills, in the Western Ghats, and when the Vaigai Dam was not built. And so the nemesis for Ramanathapuram was building a Vaigai Dam. Even though something, building a dam is good, but for Ramanathapuram it was something bad for them. Why? Because after the dam was built, there was not much water which had three crops, Ramanathapuram one point of time. It's got huge lakes. Tamil Nadu's got about 11 huge major lakes like Viranam, Chembrambakkam, Aras Mangalam Lake in Ramanathapuram, Peri area, it's one of them, it's called Wellington Lake, Perumal area, like that. You have big lakes. Each of them has about one TMC, two TMC, three TMC capacity lake. And now no water flows through to Ramanathapuram. And when Vaigai Dam was built, that was again during Mr. Kamaraj's period, I think in 59-60, there was an agreement saying that two-thirds of water should be for Sivaganga and Ramanathapuram, and then one-third for Madurai, Dindukal. The Mullai Periyar Dam, where we have problems with Kerala as well, like for the last so many years, it is, the capacity was, the height was 136 feet, and then they increased to 142. Now we wanted to about 152. There, that Mullai Periyar water, the agreement between Kerala and Tamil Nadu was that that water should be used only for Theni district, Theni Valley. And that water flows to Vaigai. And then, so that water should be used only for Theni, not for other districts. So it's a little complicated though. I don't want to go much into these technicalities though, but I just wanted to know, because none of you know what is the our situation, what is the political issues like, what impacting the our agriculture and then our water issues as well like. So, because I have been, I could talk about this, I have been to all of these places. I've seen firsthand, I've interacted with people, I have created a lot of awareness. I've gone to save our rivers. I have done a two-day campaigning for Save Tamrabarani from the source Papanasam to Punnakayal. Punnakayal is where it goes to the sea, Tamrabarani. Vaigai, 2 days campaigning, Vaigai, I've gone to the source, then gone to the end point of that lake. Kaveri, 3 days it took me. Billigundu is where, in fact, my Dharmapuri, my constituency, from there till Pumbuhar, 3 days, talking to people, telling them about the impacts, and not only about water, loss of water, but then other issue of pollution of the water we get. The pollution from Bangalore, pollution from Mysore, pollution from the chemical factories situated in Mettur, then the dyeing industry in Bhavani, and then the Tirupur industry, and then all these things like. So it's a big problem when we can't save our water, we can't get clean, good water, whatever comes like due to pollution as well. Like Palar, I'm sure a lot of would have seen the Palar near Chengalpat Bridge, one bridge will be there, Palar. Palar, the name is Palar, means one, in Tamil it's called Pal Ponrar. It used to flow like milk one point of time. Today there's not even sand there. They cleaned it up completely, like everything is gone. Palar starts from Karnataka again. It's near by Kolli Hills in Karnataka. It flows about 93 kilometers in Karnataka. And beauty is Karnataka, they checked it in 18 places, the Palar. When you say check, not only check dams, but then it checks into a lake concept, like 18 places. It flows only 32 kilometers in Andhra. It's a little bit in Andhra, Chandrababu Naidu's constituency, Kuppam. So in 32 kilometers, he has built 22 check dams. And now 6 more are being built. But the problem is check dams was 6 feet, now it's about 20 feet, 26 feet. He's added on 20 feet more. And Tamil Nadu, it flows 223 kilometers. And how many check dams we have? One. And who built that? The Britishers. Near Walajabad. Just one. So this is something where we are facing in Kollidam, a tributary of Kaveri. So in Kallanai, Karihala Cholan built it. But the positive is he built it, but the Britishers came and strengthened it. If not for, the, I think it's a rather cotton, I think. If not for him, we couldn't have seen any Kallanai today. It would have been washed away. Melanai is where it was washed away last year. I'm sure you would have seen the footage of Melanai in Kaveri where it broke, and then from there, the Kollidam, and then the Kaveri grows to Mukkombu. So Kallanai is where Kaveri branches into 5. One is the Kollidam, the Kaveri, the Vellar, and then there are 2 canals, South Bank Canal like that. So, and Kollidam is one of the biggest tributary, but the Kollidam is where the excess water, Kollidam is called Kollumidam, is it could contain how much of a amount of water, flood water like. And Kollidam, we have been asking to build 11 check dams. It's about 111 kilometers from the start to the end. And each 10 kilometers, you build a check dam. And these 11 check dams could hold nearly about 30 TMC of water. It's a huge river, it's a wide river, like so. And but this has not been, this has been the cry for those people for a long time. Another problem is not only this check dam water coming from this side, but the problem during the summers is seawater intrudes into these rivers. Whether it is Tamrabarani, Vaigai, or Kaveri, or Palar, the seawater comes into this. And Kollidam, seawater comes for nearly 20 kilometers inside. And so when it comes, then salinity increases, then there's no agriculture. So this is something where the government has to invest in this. There are big examples of big investment into these schemes. Like when I say, there are number 20 schemes, like say Attikadu Avinasi scheme. Now it is about 3,300 crores. The Tamrabarani Karumeni Nambiyara scheme, that is nearly about 800 crores. Then we have another scheme called Kaveri Gundar Thittam, Gundar scheme. Gundar is something where it's a river going through Virudhunagar. Kaveri near Trichy, the Amravati joins in. From there, take a canal. It goes through Sivagangai, Trichy, Sivagangai, Pudukottai, Madurai, and Virudhunagar. All these districts it goes, it cuts across the Vaigai and then goes across. So these schemes are excess water scheme, Ubarinir. Not the regular regular period where you have irrigation for. So that is something where these schemes, the Kaveri Gundar scheme, like, and this has been a cry for them. Like then Dindigul, we have 59th of the Kalvai Thittam. They have canals, like, so they, the 59th scheme in Dindigul. A lot of water comes through the Western Ghats. You store them and then check them there and then you take them. Then you have this. Doni Madu scheme in Metur. Then you have a Metur excess water scheme. You take 5 TMC in Metur, because Metur is Kaveri, and then that dude, it's a small pump, that's it. There are huge pump irrigations. This is a small pump, like, and you take it to, then Salem district has about Sarabanga, Tamar, Manimuttaru, Vashishta river, like. So link these three rivers so that every lakes in that district is filled up. It's filled up just for 20 days, you get water, excess water, that's all. 20 days a year. And then you do it for 3 years, then the groundwater recharges itself. Like. So that is something where these schemes cost about 1,000, 1,500 crores. Only. When I say only, it's something where for getting water, I want to spend lakhs and lakhs of crores. Like. This is going to be a hard commodity for us. Like, because they say that third world war is going to happen due to water. They were saying, now I am saying third world is going to happen due to climate change, which is so that's something where it's a very, very important topic where I think all of you should look into that, like, and go about it. So, and there's one scheme, Nandan Kalvai scheme, Nandan Canal scheme through Namalai. Then the linking of Tenpennai and the Palar scheme. Like these schemes, like there are about 20 schemes. And these 20 schemes need how much? It's about 1 lakh crores only. When I say only, again, 1 lakh crores. Let us go to examples of other states, what they did. Andhra is a perfect example. And Mr. Y. S. Rajasekhar Reddy was the chief minister. Earlier to him, the Andhra, undivided Andhra, the total cultivable land for them was about 71 lakh hectares. He invested nearly 70,000 crores for irrigation schemes only in Andhra and increased it by another 50 lakh hectares in a span of 7 years. Then today, Andhra has got one of Telangana. They have, but the problem, the advantage for them, they have two good rivers, like Godavari and Krishna. Godavari is a perennial river. Krishna was a perennial river, but sometimes now it is also going dry because due to the dams built on the Karnataka side, like so. Now, recently, Telangana government has invested for a new scheme called Kalishwaram scheme, where water from Godavari lift irrigation. They pumped lift irrigation. And they lifted for how much? 500 meters, nearly half a kilometer. And the cost is about 1,20,000 crores. And they can cultivate 45 lakh acres, two crops. And also they supply 70% of Telangana's water requirement, drinking water requirement. And the scheme was completed in just about 3 years. It's a world record, I believe, in 3 years completing a scheme for 1,20,000 crores and 45 lakh acres of cultivation plus 70% of drinking water. Just imagine. Andhra also did Polavaram scheme, water again from Godavari through to coming to Krishna. And they did it in, I think, about 170 or 200 days, the scheme. And that cost me about 1,300 crores for about 80 TMC water. I mean, if they could do, why can't we do in Tamil Nadu? Why haven't we done in Tamil Nadu? Why haven't we invested in these schemes to harness our water and increase our acreage? That is one point. Like, in Gujarat, when Mr. Modi was the chief minister there, Narmada Sarovar scheme, called Narmada Sardar Sarovar scheme, where the Kutch, Saurashtra area, there were 11 districts like, it was dried, bone dry, and then he diverted that scheme. There was again a lift irrigation. And today about 10 lakh acres, two crops, in those dry areas. Like, and then water for drinking, it's a double purpose. Madhya Pradesh, they have increased their capacity in the last about 10 years by nearly about 10 lakh hectares. And Tamil Nadu, I don't think we have done anything much in the last 50, 60 years of increasing. In fact, it decreased. It shrunk the delta. I just put you one small example, Israel. They said Israel, it has got about 50 millimeters of rain, and then it depends on the Jordan River. In Jordan, that's called a Jordan River, and then they get some water from them, and then they do it. Like, the total TMC of water used for Israel irrigation is about 32 TMC. With 32 TMC, Israel cultivates about 5 lakh acres for agriculture, with 32 TMC. And you know how much water flows through the Kaveri? 470 TMC on an average. And how much do we cultivate? 15 lakh acres. So this is something we have to learn from the other parts of the world as well, like what crops should be cultivated, multi-cropping, all these things. Like, coming to Chennai, most of you, I mean, today you are in Chennai, some of you may be living in Chennai. Like, but Chennai, if Chennai was a country by itself, I think it should have been about 110th biggest country in the world by population. Chennai, if it was a country, it would have been bigger than New Zealand, bigger than Norway, like that, some of the Nordic countries. Like, 92 lakh population in Chennai, and floating is about 1.4 crores. Like, so, and the requirement, I said, in Chennai is 1.5 TMC a day, I mean, a month. Chennai has got three rivers, or at least it had three rivers. Adyar River. From Chembrambakkam, I'm sure you would have heard the word Chembrambakkam because it was open, the sluice gates were open suddenly in the night, and then we had lots of floods around, like all these things. Like, so that Chembrambakkam, the entire Kanchipuram district drains into Chembrambakkam, and then Adyar River, it ends in Adyar. Then we have the Kosasthalai River. It starts in Andhra, comes to Tamil Nadu, goes a little bit in Andhra, and then goes into Pundi Reservoir, and from Pundi it goes, drains into Ennore. And then the third is the Kuvam, the famous Kuvam. So when you say Kuvam, then immediately it stings. But Kuvam starts near Tiruvallur, in Tiruvallur district. Tiruvallur is a village called Kuvam. So it starts from there, it runs 72 kilometers, it drains near Napier Bridge. Out of 72 kilometers, Today, 60 kilometers of Kuom River is good. You can use it for drinking. People are using it for drinking and for irrigation, for agriculture and other works like as well today. They only last about 12 to 15 kilometers. That's only the thing polluted. When it comes in Chennai, that's where the pollution starts. This could be changed. This could be offset by investments. Then in Chennai, we had a beautiful marshland called Pallikaranai marshland. None of the cities in India has such a marshland to drain, to catch how much of a rainfall you can. It all drains and it used to drain into the marshland. 1965, the total capacity, the total acreage of the marshland was about 12,500 hectares. 5,500 hectares. That's about 12,500 acres. 5,500 hectares. Today, it's about 500 hectares. So we lost out 5,000 hectares in the last 50, 60 years only. And the amount of flora and fauna in these, even today, a little bit, whatever is there. And we have completely missed out all these things. Because the governments earlier in Singapore, they take land from the sea. They reclaim from the sea and they built buildings there all around the world. But here, the government, the rulers here, they build on the lakes. They get land from the lakes. Chennai had about nearly 270 lakes at one point of time. Kanchipuram was the lake district of Tamil Nadu. And today, you don't see any much. The Coimbatore bus stand is built on a lake. Nehru Stadium is built on a lake. Mogapair, it's called Mogapair Eri Thittam. It's called Mogapair Lake Scheme itself, the name. They demolished a lake and built housing board on that. Valluvar Kotam is built on a lake. We had a big lake called Horseshoe Lake from Chetpet to Saidapet. It's a big lake in the 1940s during British period. Horseshoe Lake. Today there's no. You can see only Lake Bun Road and Lake and all these lakes, like Lane and all these things like that. Nothing much. There's no lakes available in Chennai. That's again why we're facing a problem of water shortage. Or if it rains, then you have a flood situation because there's no way this water to drain into. And that is something where we need to look into for Chennai. Chennai, we're getting water from Krishna. We're begging them getting water from Krishna. We're begging Karnataka for water and whatever comes to Viranam. Then it's a tedious process of water bringing into Viranam and then Viranam to Chennai here again as well. Whereas some of my friends, suddenly they say that, why can't we have desalination plants? We have, in fact, two desalination plants, one in Nemili and then one in North Chennai. But my friends, desalination plants are used only in desert countries, like Dubai, or Saudi, Israel, and all these things. As a tropical country, we have rain. Why should we invest 20,000 crores for a single plant and then a recurring cost of 1,000 crores a year, which has a lot of pollution, it leads into a lot of pollution and a lot of other issues. Why do we need these desalination plants? The problem in Chennai is both the rainwater, stormwater, as it joins the main drainage. It drains the sewage. It joins the sewage. This plan in Tokyo, in New York, in major cities where they plan it beautifully. They have separate stormwater drainage capacities, which stores these waters for reuse. And I'm sure most of you would have heard about a concept called grey water. This is a little micro level concept, like your house, like your kitchen water. When you, again, you clean it and then you reuse it, it's called grey water. And you can use it for your plants and washing your cars and all these things. But we have absolutely no awareness on a concept called grey water. And I don't know if the government has also. And nevulna irukke na enna vaadi enna da ro bore adikran ro pesite irukran solitte ena romba romba pesnalum adu konjam or mari irukum. So what should we do now? We Tamil Nadu should invest 1 lakh crores, maybe 1.25 lakh crores. One year, they should invest 25,000 crores. They should have a separate minister for water, irrigation water. Agriculture should have three ministers, in fact, four ministers. One for agriculture, one for horticulture, one for water, and then for irrigation too. They should plan out how we could tap all our rivers when the rainfall, whether it is Chennai or the metros and all these things. So Chennai, I just say that we have four major reservoirs in Chennai: Chembrambakkam, Sholavaram, Poondi, and Pural. And these four reservoirs plus a little smaller ones, the total capacity is only 11 TMC. The entire Tirulur district, Chennai, and then Kanjipuram, all three districts put together, the total capacity of storage is about 50 to 55 TMC of water. Entire capacity of it. Rainfall is not calculated in TMC, inches or millimeters or centimeters. But when you put it into a concept of TMC, approximately, I'm telling you, the total rainfall in these three districts is approximately about 300 TMC. But our capacity is only 50 to 55 TMC to hold it. So the others, the whatever rain we have, it runs off like. And this is going to be a problem in the future, where we're not going to have rains for 3 years, 2 years, 3-4 years continuously because of climate change, because of global warming. So we have to have mitigative and adaptive procedures, schemes to store the water we have, the water which we get. And otherwise now we're going to face a lot of problems. There's one scheme called Godavari-Kaveri linking scheme, which I think Mr. Gadkari has announced, and then of course our Prime Minister Mr. Modi has also. When I met him a couple of months ago, we were talking for about 20 minutes. And then I was talking about schemes, let's say Godavari, Kaveri, and then about these hydrocarbon issues in the Delta. I was asking him to save our Kaveri Delta. And what is required in a Delta, Kaveri Delta, is the Kaveri Delta is the best Delta in the country. But the problem here, we have ONGC drilling wells there, like, for natural gas and crude. ONGC has 700 places it started drilling, and it's got 200 wells, and now it's going to go for 44 more wells. Like. And then also now their government has given permission for drilling hydrocarbons to two companies, one ONGC and then second Vedanta. It's about 5,000 square kilometers, right, from Marakkanam to Pudukkottai. So this is going to destroy the Delta. Example was Nigeria, they have a Niger River, and the river, they had a Niger Delta. People are very happy they had three crops. Then when they found oil in that, the entire world went into that. And then today the agriculture is all displaced. They're begging, and then they have a civil war because of that. That shouldn't happen here. So that what needs is you have to have a protected agricultural zone. Kaveri Delta, protected agriculture zone by act of parliament, by law. That is the only way I can protect it. So when I was discussing this, and our Prime Minister said that last 5 years I was focusing on Swachh Bharat, cleanliness. Next 5 years, I'm going to focus on water. And he said, Godavari-Kaveri scheme. He said, whatever it takes, how much of a cost it is, I am definitely going to do it. But that Godavari-Kaveri scheme was conceptualized in 1972 by the then Water Resources Minister, at the time Mr. Rao was there. Because Godavari, approximately 3,000 TMC flows to Godavari. Out of that, nearly about 1,500 TMC goes to the sea. And this scheme is about taking about 1,100 TMC of water and supplying Telangana, supplying Andhra, and Tamil Nadu. Our share is about 300, but at least we'll get 200 TMC. And it links to the Kaveri. It's a very, very big scheme. It needs participation of Chhattisgarh, Orissa, Karnataka, Andhra, and a little bit of Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu. So we have to, getting these leaders into that, it's a big, big problem as well. Like. But then we are in the receiving phase. Like. We are in the polishers already, receiving, begging phase number. So it's in the receiving phase. Like. They are in the giving phase. Like. So we have to go to them and talk, and then the government has to do it. Like. And according to the final verdict of the Kaveri, Karnataka is supposed to give us only 177.25 TMC water every year. This scheme, Kaveri Godavari, if it happens, they will get 200 TMC water. And Godavari is a perennial river. So throughout the year, we'll get water from the Godavari. And when I say throughout the year, 200 TMC water, Kaveri, throughout the year, I'm sure Tamil Nadu, there'll be a huge, huge development of Tamil Nadu. Because water is something where not only for drinking, but for agriculture. Today, Tamil Nadu is the most urbanized state in the country. It's about, I think, 48.5% urbanization. But I don't see urbanization as a module of success. I'm not proud of saying that Tamil Nadu is the most urbanized state. Why? Because what is urbanization? People going towards the urban areas. Why are people going to the urban area? Because villages, there's no water for agriculture. There's no water to drink. There's no livelihood in villages, in the rural areas. So because of that, they are selling their land, they're just leaving it there and then coming out to the cities. And so that is not a success model of concept called urbanization. So it's a concept of migration. So we need a concept of re-migration, going back from the urban areas to the rural areas. And that what when it'll happen, like schemes like this Godavari scheme, these major schemes, investment in agriculture, investment in irrigation happens, then it will be a success module. And then people will have to go back and then have their livelihood back. Because it's very, very difficult to live there because absolutely there's no water, no livelihood, no agriculture is completely gone. Even though we have our own rivers, we have our own good rainfall, copious amount of rainfall, we don't have planning, we don't have a long-term vision, we don't have persons who could conceptualize, think about these things. And so these ideas and ideologies, that is something where Tamil Nadu needs today a lot of investment into our schemes where nature has given us a huge amount of rain, water, all these things. Like, so we need to store it and save it for our future generations. So I'll be happy to take any questions you have.
Can I have one mic on the dais for Dr. Anbumani Ramadoss as well as volunteers for the audience? I'll request Tirisham.
Simple housekeeping rules for questions. Please don't make statements. I would request you to restrict to what he has spoken, and your question should be related to the speech. So one by one.
Sir, my name is Akbar Ali. Ramanathapuram mavattathil irundhu vandirukken. Neenga Ramanathapuram mavattathu vandhu thannila kaadu appdinu solli sonninga. Ana enga oorla 20 adi 25 adiyila thonna thanni vandrum. இப்போ நான் சென்னையில் இருக்கேன், குளத்தூரில் இருக்கேன். 125 அடியில் வந்து தண்ணி இல்லை, இன்னும் 200 அடிக்கு போய்கிட்டு இருக்கு. அதை நான் சொல்லிக்கிறேன். அதுக்கப்புறம் என்கிட்ட ஒரு கோரிக்கையும் ஒரு கேள்வியும் இருக்குது. என்னுடைய கோரிக்கை என்னென்னா, ராமநாதபுரத்தை சுற்றி ஒவ்வொரு தெருவுக்கும் ஒரு ஊரணி அப்படிங்கிற அடிப்படையில் வந்து சேதுபதி மன்னர்கள் காலத்துலேருந்து கட்டப்பட்ட கட்டமைப்பு இருக்குது. ஆனால் அந்த பெரிய கம்மாய், அதே மாதிரி ஆரசமங்கலம் கம்மாய், சக்கரக்கோட்டை கம்மாய், இதிலேருந்து வரக்கூடிய அந்த தண்ணீரை எடுத்து அந்த ஏன்னா இப்போ சமீபமாக ஒரு 10 வருஷமாக மழைங்கிறது பெரிய அளவில் இல்லை, அதனால் அந்த குளங்கள்லாம் நிரம்பாமே இருக்குது. காவேரி கூட்டு குடிநீர் திட்டம் மூலமாக எங்கள் ஊருக்கு வந்து தண்ணி கிடைக்கிது. அதே போல் அந்த குளங்களையெல்லாம் அந்த கம்மாயில் இருந்து நிரப்பணும் அப்படின்னா ஒரு வருஷத்துக்கு மக்கள் பயன்படுத்துகிற அளவுக்கு வந்து தண்ணி இங்கே கிடைக்கும். இதை நீங்கள் வந்து அரசாங்கத்திட்ட வலியுறுத்தணும், இது என்னுடைய கோரிக்கை. அதே போல் அவ்வளோ பெரிய கம்மாயில் இன்றைக்கி இங்கே நின்று பார்த்தோம் அப்படின்னா சக்கரக்கோட்டை கம்மாவில் வந்து ஒரு டிஎம்சி அளவுக்கு தண்ணி சேமித்து வைக்கலாம். ஆனால் கண்ணு கெட்டின வரைக்கும் என்ன இருக்குது அப்படின்னு பார்த்தோன்னா கருவ மரம் தான் இருக்குது. அது எல்லா கம்மாயிலையுமே இது இருக்குது சார். இதை எல்லாத்தையுமே வந்து என்ன செய்யணும்னா ரிமூவ் பண்ணணும் சார். அதை வந்து உங்கள்கிட்ட கோரிக்கையாக வைக்கிறேன். அந்த குளங்களை வந்து நீரை சேமிக்கணும், அதுக்கும் நீங்கள் வந்து அரசாங்கத்திட்ட வலியுறுத்தணும். அதுக்கப்புறம் என்னுடைய கேள்வி என்னென்னா, இப்போ ரீசெண்டாக பஞ்சாப் அரசாங்கம் வந்து அங்கே உள்ள ரஜோனா அப்படிங்கிறவரை வந்து அந்த பீன்சிங் அவங்களுடைய அந்த கொலை வழக்கிலிருந்து விடுதலை செய்கிறதுக்காக ஓகே சார், இது என்னுடைய கோரிக்கை.
அந்த கோரிக்கை என் கோரிக்கைன்னு கோரிக்கை
ஓகே சார்.
சரி, நன்றிப்பா. இப்போ சொல்கிற மாதிரி பெரிய ஏரி ஆர்எஸ் மங்களம் ஏரி, இந்த காவிரி குண்டார் இணைப்பு திட்டம், இது இந்த இணைப்பு திட்டம் நடந்தால் இது வைகை ஆற்றின் மூலமாக தான் தாண்டி போவோம். வைகை ஆற்றிலிருந்து தான் தண்ணி இந்த கம்மாய் ஆர்எஸ் மங்களம் பெரிய ஏரிக்கெலாம் போகிறது அந்த பகுதியில். அதில் தண்ணி போச்சுன்னா நிச்சயமாக அங்கேருந்து மற்ற சொல்கிற மாதிரி ஒரு வருஷம் இல்லை, கம்மாய் நிரம்பிச்சுன்னா 2-3 ஆண்டுகள் அங்கே விவசாயம் பண்ணிகிட்ருக்கலாம், அதில் மிக செழுமையாக கொண்டு வரலாம். ஆனால் சொன்ன மாதிரி வைகை அணை கட்டின பிறகு தான் அங்கே பிரச்சனை, ஊரில் பிரச்சனையே வந்தது. அதுக்கு முன்பு 3 போகம் விளைஞ்சி இந்த மண் அதெல்லாம் சுற்றி இருக்கிற மண் இல்லை அது. ஆனால் இப்போ ஒன்றும் பண்ண முடியாது, அதிலே பண்ண முடியாது. கொஞ்சம் முல்லைப் பெரியாறு உயர்த்தி அதில் கொஞ்சம் வர தண்ணியில் வைகையில் போட்டு அதெல்லாம் பண்ணணும். நிச்சயமாக கோரிக்கை, என்னுடைய கோரிக்கை தான், ஆர்எஸ் மங்களம் ஏரியை நாங்கள் தூர் வாரியிருக்கோம். 20 ஆண்டுகளுக்கு முன்பு நாங்கள் ஆர்எஸ் மங்களம் ஏரியில் தூர் வாரியிருக்கோம். நாங்கள் எங்கள் சென்ஸ் எங்கள் அமைப்பு பசுமை தாயகம் வச்சுருக்கிறோம், என்ஜிஓ வச்சுருக்கோம், நாங்கள் போயிருக்கிறோம், பார்த்துருக்குறோம், அங்கே அங்கே செஞ்சுருக்குறோம் நாங்கள். நிச்சயமாக அது ஒரு கோரிக்கை. ரெண்டாவது கோரிக்கை நேரத்தில் 7 பேரும் விடுதலை பண்ணணும், என்னுடைய கோரிக்கை அந்த அது சரி தான்.
ஹலோ சார், வெங்கட் ஃப்ரம் டிஜே வைஷ்ணவ் காலேஜ். ஸோ யூ டோல்ட் அபவுட் த கான்செப்ட் ஆஃப் செக் டேம்ஸ். இஸ் இட் ப்ராக்டிகலி வயபிள் டு ஹேவ் செக் டேம்ஸ் இன் எவ்ரி லேக்ஸ் அண்ட் ஹேஸ் இட் ஆக்சுவலி ஒர்க் இன் எனி ஸ்டேட் ஆர் கண்ட்ரி? பிகாஸ் a dam is of a big size and of such a big maneuver, but a check dam is something very small and tiny as compared to a big dam. So is it actually possible to bring such check dams and make sure that these waters are saved in such check dams is my question. So has it actually worked somewhere? Okay. An example would be fine.
Okay, thank you. See, there's a program called Watershed Management Program. And the government have investing thousands of crores in these watershed management program. So like for example, Dharmapuri is a dry district. The average rainfall is about 822 millimeters. Whatever rain it happens, it goes into both rivers, Tenpanai and Kaveri. There you check the dam, check the water which flows. Small check, there you know, you need not have even 5 feet, you have just 3 feet length. And I have seen success in that, like where the groundwater table has increased. That is the, see, dams, we need to increase the groundwater table. That is the concept of a watershed management. It's not, check dams are not going to store water for you. It can store water for about 10 days or 15 days, whereas it percolates down and then, and there's huge Rajendra Singh. He was here, I think, last year, along with me. We shared. So you see his success. Like in Rajasthan, he has reinvigorated the rivers, the plantation, the forests, just using these small, small, tiny check dams. But my concept is watershed, just different. But mine is building check dams in these rivers, every 5 kilometers, every 10 kilometers. If Andhra could do 32 kilometers, they built 26 check dams. Why haven't we done it? One place called Pillur, when I was border between Andhra and Tamil Nadu, it was six feet, now 26 feet. When I went there, I saw huge amount of water. Check there. It's a forest area, nobody's going to use it there. But because of that, the water is not flowing into Tamil Nadu, where we can't check it. So whatever water is there, letting into the sea. See, some scientists may have the idea saying that we need water flowing for the marine things and all these issues. But then we need it here. Like, so check dams are very, very important. And then, so that is something where there are a lot of success stories as well. Like I said, on Palar, 5 feet, 10 feet of check dam. That's all. So there's a lot of flood, it flows over it, but it checks it for a 1 month, 15 days, 20 days, 1 month, so that the entire area, about the 10 square kilometers, are the waters goes, the percolates down.
So thank you for the very nice talk. And the climate change you talk about, it's very important than even water. So what sort of mission we have, or vision we have for the country, or specifically for Tamil Nadu? Even for water, there is not much vision for the past 50 to 60 years at all. So any specific vision we have, or naturally any cautious there, artificial, of course, I'm from Transportation Department of Anna University as a professor. So I'm thinking about for the past 10 years about the climate change.
Mm-hmm.
Lot of work is going on. But naturally, that's occurring, or artificial also, there's some percentages there. Any light on that, it would be nice.
Thank you, ma'am. Climate change is something where I have been going into these issues, like, and my organization, Green Madal, Pasumai Thayagam, has attended a lot of meetings, the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, COP. I attended COP 21 meeting and COP 15, Committee of Parties meeting. So we have had a historical Paris Convention in 2015, end of 2015, where 196 countries in the world got together and signed a declaration, first of its kind in the world, for climate. Framework Convention on Climate Change. And that declaration, all the countries have to start acting from 2020. So till today we are planning how to go about, what should be done. See, the major pollutants, we say greenhouse gases. The greenhouse gases major is carbon dioxide, nitrous oxide, then methane, then HFC, PFC, and then, CFC, HFC, ozone. So these are the major villains for us. Like, in carbon dioxide is a major one. And the main problem is the fossil fuel, burning of fossil fuel. Burning of fossil fuel and cement factories put together is a cause of 90% of the carbon emission in the world. Cement factory is the biggest villain of them. The carbon emission, ppm per particulate million, 150 years was 280 ppm. Today it has increased to 415 ppm. And the UN wants it to be reduced to at least 350 ppm, because there's a 1 degree increase. Greenhouse gases is needed for us. Without greenhouse gases, we can't live. See, the concept of climate is the sun and the sea. Ocean is, for us, we get climate. So the sun's rays and the heat comes to Earth. Part of it is reflected out. So these greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, it controls the amount of heat being reflected. So because of the increase of amount of greenhouse gases, the lesser amount of heat is reflected. So that is the cause of the global warming for us. So to reduce these carbon, reduce these methane is mainly by these cattle, growing of cattle for food. Not so much in India, but then Australia, New Zealand, Europe, America, Brazil. Out of greenhouse gas, 17% is methane. About 65% is carbon dioxide. And also agriculture, also methane produced agriculture, plus these hydrocarbon drilling and all these methane. So now what should be done is reduce fossil fuel, petrol, diesel, kerosene, LPG, all this fossil fuel. Everything under the earth is fossil fuel. Then another thing is coal. India produces this electricity by coal. Most of it is by coal, and all our coal is low-grade coal. Produces a lot of coke. The quality is low. So when you burn it, you have more pollutants, more carbon coming out. So what should be done for that is have good transport policies. And when you say transport policies, public transport, example Singapore, I'm sure all of you would have gone to Singapore. Singapore, to own a car, because they have, example, 10 years you can't use, more than 10 years you can't use a vehicle there. And after 10 years, and say 10,000 vehicles will be scrapped, they'll give a license only for 10,000 vehicles to be present. And you have to bid an auction for these 10,000 vehicles. So there, if 10,000 people or maybe 20,000 people bid, so they take into account from the highest bidder till the 10,000 person who has bid, and then they take an average of that. That is more expensive than the car itself. So they don't want them to buy a car, but you don't need a car in Singapore. And if you are driving a car, morning 9 to 11 is a peak hour, they charge you $25 to go into the road. So they discourage you basically. And you have buses, you have trains, you have metros, everything is there. So you don't need a car. So that policy, Tamil Nadu, Chennai, take for example Chennai. Chennai had 3,000 buses, public transport buses, 20 years ago. Today it is 3,400 or 3,500. Chennai needs 8,000 buses, a good quality bus, AC bus or good quality bus. And my policy, my concept is make them free. 8,000 buses, make them free for Chennai as a pilot. Everybody will use the bus. Because when you say free, and going to school, example, going to school, dropping them off, children going, coming, then evening going, picking them up. So using money, using 50 rupees, pollution, time, road, accidents, your usage, everything could be avoided. So, and when you make them free, it'll add to the economy. 4,000 people are dying in Chennai due to pollution every year. That will link together. Accidents will reduce. The fuel, the timing, everything. And the government will be a, it won't be a loss for the government. It'll be a profit for the government when you make them free. This, a lot of cities are doing this thing. Policy, electric vehicles, but the electricity to be produced by non-conventional. Again, the coal producing electricity for the electric vehicles is, it's not a win-win leg. So, solar, solar energy, wind energy. India, Tamil Nadu produces approximately 80-90% of wind energy. But the problem is the lifting of them and then grid connectivity, that's again a different problem. Garbage disposal. You shouldn't burn our garbage because we're burning it and then you have the dioxins and all sort of nonsense coming out of it. And that's in single-use plastic, banning it. Prime Minister also have announced that single-use plastic. Water management, linking of rivers, urban policy, good urban policy, having a white roof. So a lot of thinking needs to go into these. The government have to take the mitigated adaptive procedures for climate change, and immediate action should be there. So I just want all of you to have a concept of climate, declare climate emergency. We are in a state of emergency today. We just can't go around talking about it. Enough of talking, action. One small kid, Greta Thunberg, I'm sure most of you have heard of her, a Swedish kid, 16 years. Last year, she said, like, I want to protest outside the Swedish parliament for climate change, against climate change. And she called everybody, nobody came, only she went. One small girl, 15-year-old girl, she protested again in front of the Swedish parliament. Like, that was became viral. And then today she's one of the brand ambassadors. She had talked in the Congress, US Congress, and she said, I don't want your compliments. I want you to act. And then when she spoke in the UN, she said, how dare you spoil my world? I have to go to school. But instead of going to school, I'm coming here to talk about save me. My generation should be saved. And you don't have any rights to spoil it. And she called for a protest. 40 lakh people in the world, 150 countries attended a protest. 16-year-old. So if she could do it, why can't you do it? You form groups. You form close networks in your WhatsApp group saying that climate change, declaration, action. Urge the government to declare climate emergency and take action immediately to do this.
Yeah, one last question.
Sir, Prutlanda Vandarkin, sir. நீங்கள் சொன்னீங்க பாலாறு வந்து 220 கிலோமீட்டர் வந்து பாயுது தமிழ்நாட்டுக்குள்ளே அப்படின்ட்டு ஒரே ஒரு செக் டேம் தான் இருக்குது வாலாஜா செக் டேம் சொன்னீங்க
ஒன்று கட்டிட்டு இருக்காங்க
இல்லை
இந்த மகாபலிபுரத்துக்கு இது இதுக்கு முன்னாடி செங்கல்பட்டு தாண்டி ஒன்று கொஞ்சம் கட்டிட்டு இருக்காங்க
ஒன்று வாலாஜா செக் டேம் வந்துட்டு அது இருந்ததுனால கிட்டத்தட்ட காஞ்சிபுரம் பக்கம் பாலாறு ஓடி 30 வருஷம் ஆயிடுச்சு அந்த பாலம் ஒன்று கட்டினாங்க காஞ்சிபுரத்துக்கும் பக்கத்தில் ஐயங்கார் குளத்துக்கும் இடையில் அந்த பாலாறில் ஒரு பாலம் கட்டினாங்க. அந்த பாலம் கட்டி இன்னைக்கு வரைக்கும் நாங்கள் வந்து அதில் தண்ணி பாஞ்சி பார்க்கவே இல்லை, பாலாறு ஓடி பார்க்கவே இல்லை. ஒரே ஒரு ரீசன் என்னென்னா, செக் டேம்லேருந்து திருப்பி எல்லா தண்ணியும் வந்து சென்னைக்கு விட்டுடுறாங்க. ஸோ அங்கேருந்து வந்தாலும் நாங்கள் பார்த்து வந்து பல வருஷம் ஆயிடுச்சு, அது ஒரு விஷயம். ரெண்டாவது வந்து காஞ்சிபுரத்துக்கு பக்கத்தில் இருக்கக்கூடிய மலைகள் எல்லாமே வந்து இன்றைக்கி வந்து தோண்டி எடுத்துட்ருக்காங்க அந்த கன்ஸ்ட்ரக்ஷன் ஒர்க்குக்காக. ஸோ ஆல்மோஸ்ட் மலைகளும் வந்து மழைக்கு வந்து ஒரு காரணம்னு சொல்கிறாங்க. பட்டு அதுவும் வந்து போயிட்டுருக்கு கையை விட்டு. ஏற்கனவே மணல் அள்ளிட்டாங்க, மலைகளும் போயிட்டுருக்கு, தண்ணி வந்து 30 வருஷம் ஆயிடுச்சு. இது வந்து காஞ்சிபுரத்தில் இருக்கக்கூடிய நிலவரம் இதுதான். ஸோ ரொம்ப பாதிப்பில் இருக்கும். அதனால் அங்கே வந்து கொஞ்சம் நல்லா தண்ணி வர்றதுக்கான
பலார் செக் டேம் வந்து அந்த செக் டேம் கட்டினதுனால இல்லை, ஆந்திராவில் கட்டினது, கர்நாடகாவில் கட்டினதுலாம்
அது அங்கே தண்ணி அப்டு வாலாஜா வரைக்கும் வருது தண்ணி, அதுக்கப்புறம் வரல.
இல்லை, அதாவது நான் சொல்கிற செக் டேம் வந்து இப்போது ஒரு 2015 வெள்ளம் அந்த டைம் அந்த நேரத்தில் பாலாத்தில் கிட்டத்தட்ட 30 TMC தண்ணி கடலில் போச்சு.
ஆமாம், அந்த
இப்போ நான் சொல்கிறது
ஒரு ஏரியை உடச்சி விட்டதுனால
ஒரு 3 ஆண்டுகள் 4 ஆண்டுகள் ஒரு முறை வந்ததுன்னா அப்போ அந்த தண்ணி செக் பண்ணி அதுக்கப்புறம் ரீசார்ஜ் ஆகும். அதனால் நிச்சயமாக நமக்கு தேவை ஒவ்வொரு இடத்துலையும். இப்போ அதுக்கு முக்கியமான காரணம் ஏன் தண்ணி வரலைன்னா மணல் எடுத்துட்டாங்க, சுத்தமாக போன்றை மணல் இல்லைன்னா. அன்னைக்கு அன்னைக்கு கொள்ளிடம் ஆழங்காத்தான்னு ஒரு இடத்துக்கு நான் போனேன், ஐவ் சீன் தட் ரிவர் பெட். உள்ளே போனேன் தேவர் டேக்கிங் இன் டு மெஷின்ஸ் அந்த பொக்லைன் வச்சு எடுத்துகிட்டு இருந்தாங்க. பட் தி ரூல் இஸ் தே ஷுட் டேக் ஒன்லி பிட்வீன் 3 feet to 4.5 feet, 1 to 1.5 meters, ஆர் டில் த வாட்டர் டேபிள் விச் லெவல் விச் அவர் இஸ் லோவர், 60 feet தே டேக்கிங். 60 feet ஐ வென்ட் டு த பெட் அண்ட் அது கீழே வந்து ஒன்லி திஸ் கிளே, there's no sand anymore, ஒண்ணுமே கிடையாது. So that is the heart of a river. Sand is the heart of a river. It absorbs the water and then releases it slowly. மண்ணிலே இல்லைன்னா அப்புறம் தண்ணி எவ்வளோ வந்தாலும் அடிச்சு தான் போகுது, ஒன்றுமே கிடையாது. Bigger, another bigger problem is the river is like this. Those days they built canals from the river. Now the river has come down 50 feet because of sand. The canals are still on the top. So even if there's water flood in the river, no water goes to the canals because of the plundering of sand. Like, anyways, thank you.
Sir, we don't want to let you go, but this what you have elucidated or pointed out, we are going to deep dive into those points in a technical session. We have called some 4 incredible people working on water as a subject, so we'll begin that session. But thank you so much for coming today, sir. We request Shyam Shekhar to please felicitate you on all our behalf, on behalf of Tamil Nadu Young Thinkers Forum, on behalf of IIT Madras, a memento and a book on Thirukkural as well. Thank you so much, sir.
I request the output of that, I want
video. Sure, sir. We'll send you there. Thank you so much, sir. Sure, sir. I request Sriram to come and take over for the next session. We'll start it immediately. Yeah.